Lo speaker ora è Alberto Zaffaroni, Quantum Field Theory, Lessons from String Theory.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yes. Okay. No, it's okay. Okay, first of all, let me thank the organizer for this invitation to this beautiful occasion in honor of Riccardo. And I've been actually asked to give a sort of overview of interesting problem in string theory, which could be a difficult task with this audience. And so the fear of being accused of talking about exoteric things or even to be sent to hell, I should say that I have never the honor to be sent to hell by Riccardo, and hopefully this doesn't mean that he has a bad opinion of me, because I understand that everyone else has been sent to hell. So, but since I don't want to be sent to hell today, after long thinking, I decided to choose certain topics which are more at the intersection between string theory and quantum field theory. So, first of all, let me mention that, well, obviously, string theory is very old. We have one of the father here sitting in front of me. But even without thinking so far in the past, one should notice that sorry, Gabriele, but that's the... Yes, exactly. That's my by everyone in the audience at the same time. So, if you want, even the so-called first revolution in string theory came 30 years ago. So, string theory is definitely an old subject, and we know many things. But still, there is a big obstacle. The connection with experiments is still there. And we know that there are many phases of string theory. And some, obviously, well, obviously, we know that some can look very similar to the world where we live. But there are so many that we can choose one. We can't choose one. Despite this, however, there's been some progress in various directions, and typically the progress has been obtained by choosing and turning this landscape of phases to our advantage to learn something else. And, for example, we from string theory, or people working in string theory, we got many excellent results in quantum field theory. On the first counting from first principle of black hole entropy, supersymmetric black hole, but still it's an interesting observation. Many results in math, I don't want to discuss them here. And all this has been done with many techniques, which include supersymmetry, the SCFT correspondence, Brain's dynamics, supergravity, and other things. All topics that, in a sense, have been improved and have evolved from our increasing understanding of how string theory is working. So, in a sense, all these techniques are a very nice addition to the tools that theoretical physicist has at his, in his hand to study quantum field theory. And I want to address some of this, well, or some of the results in the last few years that show some connection and some intriguing relation between different objects in quantum field theory. All the things I'm discussing, in a sense, have slowly started using holography, string theory, and so on. And at the end, they have been also discussed by people working in quantum field theories only. And so the point is that using string theory, mostly the ADST the ADS-CFT correspondence in the last few years, we have learned how to attack problems in strongly coupled quantum field theory. And more recently, people even start thinking about condensed matter. So in a sense, this is not, it's a topic that I choose to discuss because it comes well with what I want to say. I will mostly discuss the conformal side of the story. So the intersection of this different topics, quantum field theory, the use of holography in string theory, condensed matter, very often there is always a conformal field theory. So in this talk, let me just choose a couple of topics just to say how this developed from, let's say, string theory or holography and move to results in quantum field theory. So let's call it curiosity more, even more than topics. So the first one, in the last couple of years, we understood that there is a very interesting connection between various objects which are typical of quantum field theory, central charges, free energy, entanglement entropy, which is something that comes in quantum mechanics and it's an important topic in itself. And let me start with a result which is very old and it's a nice result in quantum field theory is the Zamolodchik of C theorem. It works for two-dimensional theories and for a normalizable unitary two-dimensional theory. And Zamolodchik essentially proved that there is always a function that decreases along the renormalization group flow. It's also stationary at a fixed point. At a fixed point is also equal to the central charge of the conformal field theory, so an object that enters in the algebra, in the conformal algebra. Now, for example, from the point of view, and what's the meaning of this? In a sense, intuitively, means that there is always a loss of information along a renormalization group flow. So this object with this central charge, which is a sort of measure of the degrees of freedom of the theory, is always decreasing along a renormalization group flow. So if you start in the ultra, with an ultraviolet theory, you lose degrees of freedom going to the infrared. So for example, it's a long prediction of holography that at least for theories that have an holographic dual, such a function should exist. But holography, well, string theory in a sense gives you more because it tells you that such a function should exist in all dimensions, even and dot. So for even dimension, well, in a sense, okay, that field theory already explored the subject of the story. In two dimension, it was Zamolodchik, and the meaning of this object that decreases along the renormalization group flow is a central charge. You can define it through the anomaly of the conformal group. So if you take the vacuum expectation value of the trace of the stress energy tensor, in two dimensions is proportional to the curvature of the manifold where you define your theory, and the coefficient of proportionality is the central charge. In even dimension, you can always do a similar trick. For example, in four dimension, you can write the general form of the stress of the trace of the stress energy tensor on a curved background. It depends on various objects. And the study of which of these guys, C, A, and A prime, is decreasing along a renormalization group flow is a very long story. It started after Zamolodchik of paper. There was a suggestion by Cardi in 88 that this parameter called A should decrease. There have been many example in supersymmetric field theory in recent years, and so on. And last year, Komogorsky and Schwimmer proposed a proof that A is always decreasing along the renormalization group flow. And Riccardo, Polcinski, and Luti also gave other arguments in favor of this. And so in a sense, the generalization of Zamolodchik of result to even dimension is just, if you want, well, in a sense, you can always conjecture that there is a central charge which appears in the expression of the trace of the stress energy tensor, which decreases along the renormalization group flow. And in two dimension and four, well, actually we now have a proof. In six, I think things are still more complicated and confused. But The point is that, for example, from string theory and holography, there is the suggestion that this should work also for odd dimension. Let me mention that this central charge comes from anomalies, so you don't have them in odd dimension. So, for example, what happens in 3? Well, in 3, it turns out that actually, even in 3 dimensions, there is something that agrees along a renormalization group flow. In the last few years, people tried various candidates for that. For example, this one is a candidate. I will tell you something more about this object later in this talk, in the second part. So a proposal was to take the Euclidean partition function of the theory. You take your conformal field theory, you do a conformal transformation in the Euclidean, you define it on an S3. S3 is conformally flat, so you can always do, and you evaluate the Euclidean partition function. Now, there was a proposal that this particular object, again, decreases along the renormalization group flow. And this object has been essentially introduced in the last few years because, for various reasons, it's natural from the point of view of holography. And as I mentioned later, there are also a lot of results on exact computation of object like that in quantum field, in supersymmetric, at least, quantum field theory. So actually, this conjecture was first introduced for supersymmetric theory in 3 dimensions, n equal to theories, and was tested for supersymmetric renormalization group flow. Obviously, if you do a string theory analysis and you use holography, you discover that in holography, the object that you find to be decreasing along the renormalization group flow is always related essentially to the radius of the anti-de Sitter solution that corresponds to the conformal field theory. And this object actually is essentially proportional to this object. So it coincides with what holography proposed. More recently, even, there was another proposal using quantum field theory objects. And this is even more interesting in a sense because it used the entanglement entropy of a quantum field theory, which is a subject of many works in the recent years. So essentially, what is the entanglement entropy is is as defined in quantum field theory. So you suppose that you have a quantum field theory, you take a region, here is the three-dimensional picture of the space, which is two-dimensional. And I draw a circle, so A is the region inside the circle, and there is an outside, and the entanglement entropy is simply take a trace in the sense of the density matrix of quantum mechanics over the degrees of freedom that live outside the region that you are considering. So for any region, you can define this entanglement entropy, which will depend on the dimensions of this region. Now, it so happens that a few years ago, it was noticed roughly at the same time, and using the same method that Cardi and Calabrese have used to compute the entanglement entropy for quantum field theory, it has been noticed that in 2 dimensions you can give an alternative proof of Zamolodjic of theory using the entanglement entropy. So people propose, so why not in higher dimension? And indeed, more recently, after a few try with holography, various proposals based on holography, and so on, the very same people show that if you take a particular combination of this entanglement entropy, and essentially, so you take the function minus its derivative times the radius, essentially because this function is not ultraviolet finite. So for example, it's written in the line below, if epsilon is a cutoff, this has a ultraviolet divergences, but if you construct a clever object which is universal and is not depending on the cutoff, this object is decreasing with the radius, the size of the region in space. And more than that, for a conformal field theory, you can also show that this object is not so unrelated from what we defined before, because there is a divergent contribution, which is linear in the size of the circle, which is the R over epsilon term, minus F, and F turns out to be exactly the same object that I defined before. So, and another information, you check, you do your experiments with holography, the object that you compute in this way is exactly the same that is predicted by holography. So this is a it's an interesting quantum field theory general message, if you want, that very well originally and came from holography, has been tested holographically, has been tested in quantum in supersymmetric quantum field theory, and then eventually has been extended to a full proved result in quantum field theory. So here there are other interesting things that you can ask. And for example, can you prove a similar theorem in Higher dimension? And in six, there are again central charges, but I think this, the question has not been settled yet. There are papers on the subject trying to generalize Shrimmer-Komagowski proof, but they are not definitive. And there is the equal five. So now there are various candidates in arbitrary dimensions. So you have free energy, entanglement entropy, all these guys holographically are the same. In quantum field theory, it's true in three and four dimensions, and in two dimensions, it's not obvious what happens in Higher dimension. And let me also mention something that is a curiosity probably to me, but there is something to learn in one dimension, so in quantum mechanics, one will say, okay, no, we know quantum mechanics, it's not quantum field theory, we know everything. Actually, the point that from the point of view of a string theorist, if you look at conformal quantum mechanics, that's the case that you should say, okay, that's obvious. We know how to do conformal quantum mechanics in quantum mechanics. So if you look at the dual, actually the correspondence between conformal field theory in one dimension and anti-de Sitter 2 is really poorly understood. There are very few results about it. And these are interesting for many reasons. One of these is that EDS2 is the horizon of many extremal black holes. So I mentioned before one of the results coming from string theory, the counting of microstates of black hole. So this extremal supersymmetric black hole has an horizon which is anti-de Sitter 2. So you think at the horizon there is a conformal field theory 1 that is living there. And it seems if you look at the supergravity the black hole solution that interpolates between this anti-de Sitter 2 and the infinity, that they are not so different from what happens in higher dimensions. So for example, holographically, you would think that, yes, probably there is even something to learn about the equal one. So some sort of decreasing of degrees of freedom in quantum mechanics. Second curiosity, again, in the last few years, and again about holography. So holography, in a sense, is sold in all reviews and in all courses about ADS-CFT as the explicit realization that some gauge theory, not all of them, but the one that are involved in the duality, really behaves as strings, as predicted many years ago in the 70s by many people, in particular Toft, by using quantum field theory arguments. So the basic quantum field theory argument that makes you suspect that gauge theory should behave as a string is the Feynman expansion. If you do the Feynman expansion at large n in a clever way, this is the Toft limit, your Feynman graphs organizes according topology. So according topology means that you can draw a similar picture with Feynman graphs for strings, which resemble the conformal field theory. So you have an expansion in genus 0, genus 1, and so on. And genus 0 is the planar contribution. And when we finally add an explicit example using the DS-CFT correspondence, this is the way in which it works. If you compute something in Anti de Sitter, the classical result is the three-level one, and you also are in the limit where you discard the higher derivative term. And in principle, since you have a string theory background, you can include one loop, quantum gravity correction, which are the loops, and even higher derivative terms in your action. It's obviously more difficult because you have to solve a problem in string theory, but you think that there is a perfect matching between the expansion in graphs of a conformal field theory, which has an holographic dual, and a supergravity solution. Now, so if you look at the zoo of conformal field theory that you find in the string literature, and focusing only on the supersymmetric one, the simplest one, so I choose maximal supersymmetry to have a well-defined object, a unique one. So the string theory propose a good duality, examples of dualities in essentially all dimensions. The original one is the one with Anti de Sitter 5, and in correspond with to a very nice quantum field theory, n equal to 4, super Yamils, that we know is conformal, as many other interesting features like integrability in the large limit, and so on. So this is the well-known example and the original example of the correspondence. Then you can check other dimension. In the five past years, we understood also what happens in 3D. So in 3D, instead of having a Yamils, you have to take a Trans-Simon theory. There are highly supersymmetric Trans-Simon theory, and I'm not discussing the detail of the theory, but you should think at this model in 3D like something which is less conventional in field theory because it has no Yamil's kinetic term, which is not conformal in 3D. The kinetic term is replaced by Chern-Simon, but for everything else, this theory, which is a bit complicated, has many fields and so on, it's much more complicated than n equal 4, it's closely related to n equal 4. So it's a similar example in 3D. And again, in the large end limit, people prove that there is integrability and so on. And more than that, there are examples in 5 and 6D. These are more exotic, clearly. So typically, we think that there are conformal field theory of this kind because we realize it on brains with certain configuration. But now, if you check what's going on in from the gravity side, you discover, OK, the ADS5, n equal 4, is well described by a string theory. The other example, actually, in certain limits, are actually described by the so-called M theory, which was one of the results of the, let's call it, the second revolution in string theory, which, again, it's almost 20 years ago. And M theory has only an effective description in terms of 11-dimensional supergravity. We think that is a theory of membranes, but we don't know how to quantize membranes, so it's not exactly clear what M theory is. We know that there is, and it, in a sense, after compactification, becomes the string theory that we know. And if you look from the point of view of quantum field theory, these theories are slightly different because you may want to compute their free energy. So you sum the vacuum to vacuum graphs in this field theory. So let's take n equal to 4. If you take the free energy scales like the number of colors squared because number of colors squared is the number of degrees of freedom in your theory. And you're happy. Well, again, it's a very long prediction from string theory, it goes back to 98, that all these other examples should behave in a very funny way. For example, in 3D, if you do an holographic computation of how the free energy of the theory behaves, you discover that it doesn't go like the number of color to the square, it goes like the number of color to the 3 over 2. And if you go to 5, you find another number, 5 over 2. If you go to 6, you find n cubed. And these numbers are difficult and puzzling to understand from the point of view of field theory. Again, this was a suggestion from string theory many years ago. And again, it matches very well what happens in field theory because something that happens recently is that, again, so four supersymmetric theories, so let me take the supersymmetric theories as a a zoo of exactly solvable model where you can test some conjecture. For supersymmetric theory, we actually learn in some cases how to compute partition function using old tricks in supersymmetry, localization, and these kind of things. And for example, if you have, this is the model that I mentioned before, so the theory that is replacing n equal to 4 in 3D, this Chern-Simons theory, people were able to evaluate the free energy in an exact way with a quantum field theory computation. So they were able to compute the partition function of this theory on a trisphere. And this is the exact result. So it's still very complicated, but it's a matrix model. It's much more simple than a quantum field theory. So if you want, all the other excitation has been integrated out, and you remain with something that you have to evaluate as a matrix model. Here you see there are two integrals because this theory depends on two gauge group, essentially. And obviously, if you evaluate this matrix model, if you go to the right limit, you discover that this free energy behaves as n to the 3 over 2. So again, this prediction from string theory is fulfilled by an explicit computation. But from this point of view, there is something, in my opinion, even more strange, because it seems that the phase diagram of this theory is more complicated of the one we are accustomed to. So for example, we already say that, okay, this picture of gauge field theories that behaves as strings is good in the Lagrange limit, in the Tuft limit. So in this example, there is a coupling constant, which is this parameter k, and the Tuft constant is the ratio between the number of color and this coupling constant. Let's call it x. So the typical diagram that one shows for explaining the correspondence is this one. You plot the number of color on the vertical axis and the coupling constant on the horizontal one. So obviously, in the region where the coupling constant is small, you are in the perturbative region. You do your computation with quantum field theory, Feynman graphs, you resum them. This corresponds essentially in string theory to a regime where actually the coupling constant, or the string coupling constant, is large, and the curvature is big. So is the situation where the string is strongly coupled. But then you have perturbative quantum field theory and you are happy. In the other corner, in this green corner, there are strings. So the strings have two parameters of expansion, alpha prime and the coupling constant. The coupling constant means that we are going to the string coupling constant small means that you are going to the Lagrange limit. Taking the curvature small means that you are going to a strongly coupled regime. So the green one is the string theory regime, where these parameters are tuned in such a way that you have a nice, good description in terms of weakly coupled string theory. But so, for example, in 3D, you learn also that there is another region again, because essentially in string theory is the region where you go from a string theory in 10 dimensions, which is type 2, to the 11-dimensional version of the story, this M theory. And there is another limit where you, it's not the Tuft limit, you take a very strange limit where the number of color is much bigger than the fifth power of the coupling constant. So it's not clear to me what it means in field theory. So if you look at the Feynman graphs, they will blow up. But still, there is this sort of prediction that in this limit, there is a nice, probably, description in terms of membranes. And so what about this description? We still don't know if there is something analogous in field theory. There is one in string theory. So there are phases, and the green phase is the one that we know. The free energy behaves like the number of colors squared. So you do your Feynman graphs, you get your number of degrees of freedom, and when you compute the free energy, you get an unexpected result. It goes like the number of degrees of freedom, the number of gluon, which is n squared. But then there is another phase, which is essentially the one where you send in a clever way the number of colors to infinity, but the coupling constant is fixed. So it's not the Toft limit, I don't know what it is. It seems that there is such a limit also in field theory. And in this limit, from the explicit computation that you can do using the matrix model, you discover that the free energy goes like to the n to the 3 over 2. Actually, this is not the end of the story. If you want to do other things and reduce a bit the supersymmetry, you can even go to another version of the type 2 string, which is massive type 2. And here you discover that things are even uglier. So the free energy goes like n to the 5 over 3. And for this, there is at least one field theory computation for this which matches, but still it's unclear why it should go like that. So an obvious question is, does this, let's call it membrane description of the theory, have analogous in field theory, except from the fact that we can evaluate something and it matches with the result from string theory? Let me close this saying that from the point of view of a string theorist, there is an even more strange theory which up to now have eluded all possible descriptions, quantum field theory description, which is a fixed point in six dimension. So I don't tell you how it arises. It arises in terms of brains. It was one of the first examples that came up looking at brains. You look at five brains in M theory. And so what we can say? We know that this is still a fully supersymmetric example. We know that it fulfills the classification of conformal field theory. If you look at the classification of superconformal field theory, you discover that the maximum dimension where you can have a superconformal field theory is 6. And there is a theory which has this kind of, in 6 dimensions, you can have chirality. So you call this supersymmetry 2,0. And you can have such a theory at least from the algebraic point of view. It is realized on 5 brains. Again, that's a very funny system because the kind of degrees of freedom that you have if you, for a string theory, is usually you picture things in quantum field theory by drawing brains and open strings ending on brains. And on brains, you have strings ending, but the end point of a string is a particle on the brain. So on the brain, you think, okay, I have a theory of particles. On a 5 brain, there are membranes ending on this guy. So in a sense, the degrees of freedom are string-like. So it's a very strange object. In a sense, for us, is the matter of everything else from the point of view of quantum field theory, because if you compactify on a torus, you get n equal 4 superior males. If you do other compactification, you get other interesting things. So from the point of view let's call it field theory, is like this M theory for string theory. There is no coupling constant, so it's difficult to discuss, except the number of colors, so it's difficult to discuss this theory. And there is no Lagrangian, because it's a theory of self-dual tensor. So the point is, what the hell is this guy? The string theorists think that there is such a fixed point in 6 dimensions. They also think that it should obey all the axiom of quantum field theory, so no, it's not an exotic object, but the question, one of the main open questions is how you describe this. So I think I have just 2 minutes. And obviously, I haven't even touched the real world. I was discussing lessons in abstract quantum field theory that you can extract from string theory. What about the real world? That's probably the question that Ricardo would have asked if I wouldn't have avoided to mention this. And the answer is, I don't know if it is satisfactory or not. There are good news and bad news. Good news is that the holographic models, which are our tools to solve strongly coupled dynamics, are okay. They give toy models, which are which you can solve in an exact way of quantum field theory at strong coupling, where you don't have any other tool for discussing this. The bad news that, okay, they are typically solvable, but if you look at an equal four and model for QCD that come from holography, they are not really like QCD. So in the limit where you can trust them, there is typically, they work at large end and strong coupling, and in this limit, there is a large separation of scale in the spectrum. So you can have glue balls which are related one to the other by a power of the coupling constant, which is lambda to 1 to the 4, for example, in models based on n equal 4. And lambda is large, so you have glue balls that in real life are same order of magnitude, which are really well separated. So these are the bad news. So what people did, well, the hope is to use holography for looking for universal behavior. So you can get quantum field theory, general quantum field theory theorems, as we discussed before. And more recently, as you certainly know, there's been many attempts to study other things where there are no available methods. So to study real-time physics, transport phenomena, and here I would mention the Wilson quark gluon plasma. So for example, again, about universality, there is this result as not really an upper bound, but an holographic general result for the ratio between viscosity and entropy, study finite density, and more recently studying condensed matter quantum critical points. So you study strange metals, liquids, non-Fermi liquids. In all these cases, other methods are not available because lattice is not working, and from the point of view of condensed matter, you are at strong coupling, so you don't know how to do with your electrons. So the question obviously is if we can really learn something about physics here, and the answer, I think, is I don't know. We should wait for this. Certainly, it's an interesting, again, as I said at the very beginning, in my opinion, these are very interesting tools for theoretical physics. Oh, the list of omissions about the main part of the talk, so the lessons in quantum field theory from string theory is very large. So I haven't mentioned theories of with eigenspin, which have in which there is a lot of activities nowadays. I haven't mentioned results on counting of microstates of black hole. The part with mathematical physics, the relation, this AGT conjecture, world crossing, there are a large literature on the subject. I haven't mentioned, only in passing, the applied EDS CFT and many other things. So let me finish just with a minute thanking Riccardo for essentially many things. So I came several times to Scuola Normale thanks to Riccardo. I never had the honor to write a paper with Riccardo, but I wrote many papers with students of Riccardo. And as someone already said, he had a very good series of students. And obviously, it's a pleasure to talk about physics with Riccardo or any one of his students. There is always much to learn.
Well, I suppose that one thing that you covered only rapidly was the use of holography to compute entanglement entropies. Popular also in other areas.
In a sense, you can use holography to compute many things for particular theory at strong coupling. So holography works very well. I mean, you can compute everything, including this entanglement entropy. As I briefly mentioned, I haven't told you anything about how you compute in holography. You can compute central charges, you can compute free energy, you can compute this entanglement entropy. It's a classical computation in gravity. You typically evaluate an area. And in this particular case, if you check the holographic computation and you compare with the quantum field theory one given by Casino Huerta, you find exactly the same result. But again, holography works for particular theories at strong coupling.
I wonder why so little is done in the opposite direction, namely, what can we learn about strings in highly curved space-time from weakly coupled field theory?
Yes, well, I think people tried, and it seems to be difficult, but well, obviously, here the question is, can I learn something about black holes, quantum correction in black holes from theories which are weakly coupled in field theory? That's some sort of interesting question. Well, in a sense, all this activity in Higher spin goes in that direction. But again, the example that people study where you can check many things are ADS3, where there's a conformal field theory 2, where you also have tools to resum the alpha prime correction. Well, in a sense, recently there is a lot of activity which is related to this point, because Higer spin theories are the phase where alpha prime is small. Alpha prime is large.
No.